Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Let us bow for invocation, please. Lord, we thank you for this day and for allowing us this opportunity to conduct the business for Alamance County. I pray that we'll be fair and honest and know right from wrong as we conduct the business of the county. I pray that we look after our military and that they will be brought home soon. Please lead us and guide us as we make the decisions for the county. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, next is public comments, and our first person is David Blair. Mr. Blair. Do want to remind you have 3 minutes on public comments.
Y'all doing well tonight?
Good.
It's good to see you. I'm here tonight as an individual citizen, not as the representative of any group. In the weeks since the U.S. Department of Justice initiated its investigation of our Sheriff's Department, the county's response has deteriorated from merely disturbing to downright disgraceful. Efforts to stall and stonewall, such as the county attorney's directive that investigators not interview Sheriff's Department employees without his permission, as well as his attempt to impose a county-crafted management plan on a federal investigation, could lead any reasonable person to conclude that despite protestations to the contrary, the county does have something to hide. One is left to wonder why, if we have nothing to hide, the county attorney is so busy creating smokescreens. The stalling and stonewalling were bad enough. But the county attorney's recent efforts to intimidate citizens who are assisting or who have provided evidence to the investigation are nothing short of shameful. Considering that these actions, while perhaps not designed to do so, have the effect of putting county resources in service of elected officials' political campaigns, they are a disgrace to this county, a disgrace to its citizens, and a disgrace to this board. You, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, have within your power the ability to set things right. And so I'm here to urge you to put an end to these ill-considered activities by ordering the county attorney to immediately begin full and complete compliance and cooperation with the Justice Department's investigation. This cooperation should start by providing the investigators with free and unfettered access to all information they deem relevant to their inquiry. It should continue with the establishment of a schedule by which the investigators will conduct interviews with all Sheriff's Department personnel in a private conference room made available for that purpose without the presence of the sheriff or the county attorney. And your order should also direct the county attorney to end all activities that could be construed as efforts to intimidate witnesses, such as making public records requests to their employers, demanding access to their email accounts, and seeking the names of persons who have provided information to the tip line. I urge you to take this action not merely because it is within your power, but because it is your duty. As elected officials of the state of North Carolina, you are bound by your oath of office to support and maintain the Constitution and laws of the United States. As this investigation seeks to determine whether our Sheriff's Department has run afoul of federal laws or constitutional prohibitions, you simply cannot fulfill your oath of office without giving this investigation your full support.
Your 3 minutes is up now, Mr. Blair.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, is she?
Madam Chair.
Ms. Hook has the she has the, I don't go by that clock.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Commissioners. I remember, I want to read you something you say. I looked at tape this morning, particularly with you and Eddie and Judge J.B. Allen. Support and maintain the Constitution of the United States and the laws and the Constitution of the United States and the laws therefore. Now, I'm hereby Article 1 of the United States Constitution. We can skip the free press. I get my free speech. I want to read you here. It says, comma, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Now, I've done that since I was around 20 years old. A friend of mine got shot when I came, and this is in Alamance County, and I took 18 witnesses when they said they couldn't find one to the DA's and stuff, Investigator Flack, about a friend of mine getting shot. They took none before the grand jury and found accidental shooting with the grand jury because of who the citizen was. Now, jumping to more recent events, because it isn't time for all the other battles I've fought, since I've took up and this with the county with y'all and the sheriff's department and whatnot, I've had a sitting state representative say on public airways, and I'm paraphrasing, it is off his medication. The same one who's running for an office now said last week he's mentally unstable on public airways. A commissioner, when I was here fighting for my right to the county line, I made a comment on the radio, got a personal call from the gentleman, and he was literally cussing and livid and said, you and that woman shot yourself in the foot. Now, I've had about enough of it. And now Mr. Albright, without asking me what I provided, brings out the letter and my name and mentions it in the letter to the DOJ, which makes the paper, like I'm part of some conspiracy. If he had asked me, I wouldn't have shown him evidence, but I told him everything that I said. And here we stand. I feel intimidated, but I'm not stopping. I do feel intimidated. I think Clyde has tried to intimidate me. I think he has tried to intimidate anybody else that we put up there. Now, I do not feel it's right for y'all to sit quietly and let's just continue. I ask that you take all possible actions to stop these political actions and act to see that the DOJ investigation proceeds so that we, the citizens of Alamance County, can make a informed vote in November. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you. Tony Cox?
I wish I was a minority. I'd have people trying to help me.
If you wait long enough, you'll be right.
Well, I really am, but my color says, or what other people say, but anyway. I seen this newspaper article back in June of this year, and it says the county planner gives record company thumbs up. And it talks about Jason Martin and attorneys for Battleground Towing and Recovery and them being in violation of the high impact land use ordinance. Back in 2007, y'all brought me in here and made me a demon. And all I was trying to do was run a business. But Battleground Tire and Wrecker was able to run their business out there because they proved grandfathering by saying that they sold parts since the 70s. And this ain't about Battleground Tire and Wrecker. God, I hope they make billions of dollars. But I couldn't do it. And I was just wondering why. Because I was trying to do the right thing. And so, why would a big business out there like that, that was an illegal business just like myself, supposedly, if they can make mistakes, why can't I? And, you know, it destroyed my life. And I was just wondering why, if somebody would tell me.
Well, Mr. Martin will have to answer that.
Well, that answer is not clear either.
You need to talk with him because this is not for discussion.
Well, you know, you say it's not the floor for discussion, but it was the floor discussion when you did it.
Not on public comments, though.
Well, how do we get it on the agenda? We don't need lawyers.
You just call Mr. Honeycutt or call Pat, and we'll talk about that.
You know, it ain't right.
But it's not open for discussion. Okay, that's all at this time. I will close public comments, and I will open a public hearing for the Rural Operating Assistance Program Funding 2010 and 11. Does anybody have any comments about that? Anybody got any questions about it? You guys got any questions on that? Mr. Martin, would you like to comment on that?
Just to briefly go over this. This is, you should have in your packets a memorandum from me regarding the ROPE funding for fiscal year 2010-2011 and the allocation breakdown. Also included there are the sub-allocation worksheets for the formula funding for this year and for the supplemental funding. We will get additional there. And the two sub-recipients are the Department of Social Services and the Alamance County Transportation Authority, receiving the EDTAP funding, and then the Rural General Public Transportation funding. And the Department of Social Services receives the Employment Work First funding, which they work with Alamance Community Services with the Wheels to Work program to do car repairs, and then also the supplemental funding. I believe DSS is developing programs this year for gas cards and things like that to help people that need transportation to work, and also to partner with the Transportation Authority if they need bus service and so forth. The last thing you have in there are actually the breakdowns of the proposed EDTAP allocations for 2011. This is the breakdown of that individual funding and services that are provided to the agencies on the left by the Transportation Authority. This is proposed. It has not been approved. I believe, Dennis, this is Wednesday. Normally we have this information now ahead of time, but the way that the dates fell this year and the short timing we had to get a public hearing in, it was unfortunate. So, and I do apologize for that. But I will be glad to take any questions you all have at this time. And as well, Dennis Williams is here and Susan Osborne are here as well. So,
Dennis, you don't see any problem with it with this proposed
EDTAP, do you? Ma'am, it's very similar historically to the previous allocation. Okay.
Organization you'll see at the bottom of that list, I think, for $900, and that's an organization we've worked with before a couple
okay.
years ago.
Okay, I did see that. Anybody else got any questions for either one of them?
And Madam Chair, if I may, if there are anybody in the public that want to make comments, I also have forms here for them to fill out if they want to make written comments regarding the program.
You might just say Mr. Martin. Okay. Well, at this time, I will.
We need a motion.
We need a motion. I'll make a motion.
So moved. I'll second.
A motion and a second.
All
in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. And at this time, I will close the public hearing. Okay, the next is Special Olympics presentation. Brian Haygood.
Good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to speak this evening. I'm here tonight to ask that you join me in recognizing outstanding athletic achievements in our local Special Olympics program. This year, three athletes from the Alamance County Special Olympics competed at the National Games in Lincoln, Nebraska. These National Games are held every 4 years, and athletes are chosen from gold medal winners at the state level. And this year, Bobby Vance and Doug Bailiff from Alamance County competed in the National Games in nine-hole alternate shot golf. And Maura Bailey, also from Alamance County, competed in aquatics events. All three athletes medaled in their sports at the national level. And they also received the Laurel Wreath Award from Governor Bev Perdue, which is the highest honor given to athletes in the state of North Carolina. Mara won bronze medals in 50-meter backstroke, 50-meter breaststroke, silver in the 50-meter freestyle, and bronze in the 25-meter freestyle relay. Bobby and Doug won silver medals each in three matches in alternate shot golf with scores of 59, 51, and 55. And I'm very pleased to have Bobby Vance here with us this evening. Bobby has his medal that he won at the national level competition. Bobby's been in the Alamance County Special Olympics program for over 27 years, and he does golf, bowling, and he also participates in spring games. So I'd ask that you please join me in saluting Bobby and this outstanding athletic achievement. We're very glad that he was able to come tonight. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Bobby, would you come up, please?
Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say congratulations.
Thank you. You're welcome.
You keep up the good work.
Good job.
Also, at this time, I'd like to introduce you to Scott Revis. Scott is our Special Populations Coordinator for the Alamance County Recreation Parks Department, and he's also the coordinator for the local Special Olympics program. Scott's been with our department and been in charge of the local Special Olympics program for over 2 years. He does a fantastic job working with over 800 athletes, 140 different coaches, and almost 2,000 volunteers in our local county Special Olympics program. Scott was named recently the Northern Piedmont Area Coordinator of the Year for 2010, and this was in recognition of his successful program here in Alamance County. And it also gives me great pleasure to let you know that Scott was recently awarded the 2010 Special Olympics of North Carolina Coordinator of the Year. This award is given by a committee of athletes, coaches, and volunteers from all over the state of North Carolina who review all 108 programs around the state. Now, this is quite an honor for Scott, and I believe one that he is most deserving of. A very hardworking fellow. His commitment to Alamance County Special Olympics is evident in his dedication to our athletes both on and off the field. And I think this award is a credit to him and our program and to our county, too. So, Scott, congratulations. Thank you very much, and thank you both for
thank
coming
you,
this evening.
Thank you, Scott, for all your work. Okay, next is Susan Osborne, Central Services. We have some good news.
I'm going to let the hard workers make those announcements.
Good news.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. I'm Linda Allison, Assistant Director with the Department of Social Services. We're here tonight to give you a brief update on our progress and compliance with Family and Children's Medicaid. I'd like to introduce LaTanya Hall. She is the Economic Services Program Director for our agency, and she will give you the update. If you have any questions, we're here to answer those tonight. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Will you tell about Ms. Dalton?
I will. Our state Medicaid program rep, Rhonda Dalton, is also here for any questions or further clarification that you may need.
Thank you.
Okay. The Division of Medical Assistance does a monthly report card, and the monthly report card measures the percent of applications that are processed timely or processed, approved, or denied timely. And 90% is the threshold that we have to meet here in Alamance County in order to have passed the report card. DMA also allows us to get waivers on the report card, and we can submit waivers when we have circumstances beyond our control that have prevented us from meeting the compliance thresholds. As you saw in your memo, during 2008, we experienced continuous staff turnover, dramatic increases in applications and caseloads, and had at least 7 frozen positions. We did fail the report card 9 of 12 months during that time. In February of 2009, we were placed under a corrective action plan by the Division of Medical Assistance. From June 2009 through July 2010, we have passed the report card for 14 consecutive months, and we are released from our corrective action plan effective August of this year, and a copy of that letter was also submitted to you earlier. In February of 2009, the Board of Commissioners, you all approved for us vital resources that helped us become successful. Two additional staff members, an automation software. You granted us permission to contract with a staffing agency, and we were also provided permission to be waived from the 90-day freeze for some of our positions. I would like to highlight some of the differences that we have seen after receiving those additional resources. As I said earlier, in 2008, we failed the report card 9 of 12 months. In 2009, we failed 5 of 12. But as I said, we've passed 14 consecutive months since June 2009. The average number of overdue applications for 2008 was 160 applications. For 2009, it was 162. But thus far this year, we've only had an average of 41 overdue applications. Staff, of course, was overwhelmed, often disengaged, and undertrained. But since these changes, over the past year, we've had 7 meetings that have included additional training for our staff, meetings with management and staff, which has improved our communication, and we've discussed some kind of agency policies and workflow changes. These opportunities have provided our staff with the opportunity to take ownership of their work, and also, as I said, to receive additional training. Despite the increase of 1,169 new cases that we've seen just this year, we continue to deliver timely and accurate services to our citizens of Alamance County in the Family and Children's Medicaid program. And I would like to say thanks for your support in that measure. As I said before, Rhonda's here. Rhonda Dalton, our state rep, is here if you have any questions, and I would be happy to answer any questions for you as well.
Anybody have any questions? Mm-hmm. No, but I want to say thank you for all your hard work and accomplishing this. I think that's fantastic.
Thank you very much.
I want to say that I work with Ms. Dalton in Orange County. So, and she went to the state, and I had to go home. I just retired.
No, you retired before I left.
Oh, yeah, I did. But we had a good relationship, and I know how hard it is for you guys, and I really appreciate it because I worked there. I was in social services, and I do know how hard it is and what you guys have to go through. They used to beg me to go to income maintenance, and I'm like, nope. I'm staying in the money part of it. So, but thank you so much, and I want to thank Susan for all the hard work, and Rhonda, thank you for monitoring, and just thank you. We appreciate what you do.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, Sherry Hood, you are next.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, I'm here tonight to give an update on the Employee Health Care Clinic. As you recall, this is a clinic that we opened in February of this year, so we're at our 6-month mark, and I just wanted to give you an update of how it's gone so far. Basically, the goal of the center was to provide urgent care for our employees, their dependents over age 18, and any retirees that we have that are under the age of 65 and not Medicare eligible. The clinic is open 25 hours a week, and we have averaged 170 visits a month. And this has been things like primary care, urgent care, blood work labs, health screening, basically the services that they could have gotten from their primary care physician. But what we found was we had a lot of employees that didn't have a relationship with a primary care physician. This clinic is dedicated to just these people, so we've seen them be able to get in and out quickly, get back to work, and also we've seen people go to the doctor a little quicker than they would have if they had had to make an appointment with their primary care physician. The way that we have tracked this clinic is basically put to each visit a cost avoidance cost. So we have calculated that over the 6 months, our cost avoidance, which would have been what we would have normally incurred had they gone to their primary care physician, gotten lab work there, or any procedures there, the cost avoidance has been around $141,000. Our cost to operate, which includes staffing and supplies, and our cost, our startup cost, were around $108,000. So we feel like we've avoided about $32,000 in cost over the past 6 months. If you were to say that, if you were to annualize that, we think it's about $64,000. And then next year, when we're able to take our startup cost out, we're thinking that our savings will be around $88,000. What I probably didn't put in there, or I did put in there, was when we started this clinic with ARMC, they also gave us additional discounts for their hospital services, and those net out to about $22,000 a year. So we feel like next year our savings will be around $109,000, $110,000. So that's just putting together the cost avoidance figures. But the really exciting thing is when you look at our medical and drug claims for this past year, the total cost, and this was the fiscal year ending June 30th, were almost $4.9 million. But this was a $53,000 decrease from the year before, which is, if you know anything about the rising health care cost, I think it's incredible that we actually saw a decrease in our cost. I feel like this was a combination of what we've been able to do with the clinic, and then, as you recall, last year we also made some changes to our drug formulary as well. So I think those savings were a result of those two things, and we're excited that we're able to contain some of our health care cost. And I just wanted to come before the board tonight and give you a six-month update and tell you how much we appreciate the support of the board in making that clinic possible.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
This is good news.
Yeah, it is.
A lot of hard work. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, you're up again.
I'm up again.
You're up again.
All right. So now that I saved some money, we have to spend some money.
Nice choice here.
What you'll see is that the insurance committee and the personnel committee have been meeting and talking about things, and one of our concerns is in our workers' compensation fund. Over the past 4 years, we're averaging about $600,000 a year being spent out of our workers' comp fund. And basically, those costs are medical care for on-the-job accidents, and then we're required by state law, to anyone that's out for more than 7 days due to an accident, we have to pay them 66% of their salary, and that comes out of this fund as well. So what we'd like to do is look at ways to reduce these expenses, and really what we're looking for is ways to decrease our on-the-job injuries, get people the proper care, and get them back to work quickly. We'd like to look at doing that through adding an occupational health nurse. The challenge that we have in human resources is that we just don't have the medical expertise to follow and provide case management to employees that are out sick. And a lot of times what you see is that the employee goes to the doctor, they have a really good relationship with the doctor, and the doctor doesn't get the perspective from the county on, you know, what are the things, what are the light duty things we could be offering that employee to get them back to work. And then there's not a person following up to say, did you make your appointment, you know, have you made your follow-up appointment, and making sure those things get done. And so for those reasons, we would like to add an occupational health nurse. In addition to the case management that this person could provide for workers' comp, we feel that they could also help us in the safety committee, and then also help us on our wellness program as well. And I think some of the things they could do is help us with providing OSHA training. There's lots of yearly training that's required. It takes a lot of time and effort to get that training, and we feel it would be good to get that training from one person. Right now it's being offered to different departments by different people, so there's not a good oversight of is everybody getting the proper training. And then this person could also administer our drug testing, which right now ARMC is doing that, but we could bring that in-house and have that done here. So for that reason, we'd like to make the recommendation to contract with ARMC for 38 hours a week. This would be an on-site nurse dedicated to occupational health and wellness. The contract that they have given us is $71,440. we would take that cost and divide that between the insurance fund and the workers' comp fund because we feel the nurse would be helping us in both of those areas. I've given you a copy of the contract, and I'm ready to answer any questions that you might have regarding the proposal.
So this actually is no new money?
No, it's no new money. Mm-mm.
Where would she be housed? At the health department? Or
she
when you say
would,
here?
It would actually be in this building.
Oh,
we
okay.
are looking at a place in this, an office in this building. We're looking at something that would be close by to human resources so that she would have a contact with human resources. But this, I say she, could be he, but this nurse would actually report into ARMC but would need a contact here. And we figure if we put it in this office, a lot of our injuries are coming from the sheriff's office and EMS, and it would be kind of a central location.
Sounds good.
You mentioned as your primary target, workers' comp. How many people do we have on workers' comp right now?
Let's see. In the last 6 months, we've had 43 injuries. Of those, four of those cases resulted in days away from work, meaning that we weren't able to find them light duty. We've had 215 days of someone being on restricted duty. That's just in 6 months. Last year, we had 72 cases. The year before, it was 115, and the year before that, it was 151. I'm a little bit concerned about that 151 number because we're not sure that how accurate that is. There were, it's not just us deciding whether it's a recordable injury. We've purchased a program to help us make that determination. So that may be a little bit high. But it's very costly if we are not able to get them back to work quickly.
All right, Charity, did I understand you correctly? You said after 7 days out, we have to pay them 66% of their salary.
Mm-hmm.
You said that's state law.
Mm-hmm.
Is that all states?
I'm not certain about that. I know that's North Carolina law.
Thank you.
For me,
uh-huh.
You know, first we do the clinic, now we do this.
Right.
There appears to be some crossover here.
Yeah, I understand that.
Can you show me why the majority of this would not be?
Right. Alamance Regional, when we started the clinic, said they do not want to be involved in workers' comp. So we cannot send our workers' comp cases over to the clinic. Right now, our workers' comp cases are going to Cronodal Clinic for initial visit, and then if they need to be referred out, they're referred out from there. Our challenge is that we don't have the medical expertise to say when we don't have that person with the medical expertise going with the employee to the visit to say, okay, well, you're saying that your job won't allow you to do this, this, and this, but we can have alternatives to it. And by the way, that's only 5% of your job. So it's that piece of the doctor sometimes doesn't get the full picture. And it's also the piece of, you know, when we're getting doctor's notes in, we don't always know what they mean, and we're not always, the doctors are not always forthcoming in communicating to us exactly what those things mean as well. So the healthcare clinic is more for the wellness piece. The occupational health nurse is more for workers' comp. But the clinic is so overwhelmed with the numbers going through there that they're not able to do health maintenance counseling with employees, which is the wellness piece I'd like for the occupational health nurse to do. And that is, you know, we could have this person doing blood pressure checks, which they could do at the clinic, but the clinic's not going to have time to spend 15 minutes or whatever doing counseling with them. And that's the piece where if we could have that little bit more of a relationship, that would help. The other piece I'd like to see the occupational health nurse do is, since she would be knowledgeable about all of the injuries, she could watch trends that are happening in injuries and recommend trainings. Like, you know, if we see lots of back injuries for EMS, well, maybe we need to do some extra back training lifting, training, that sort of thing at EMS. So there's just not a person that's kind of watching those things, and that's really what we'd like the occupational health nurse to do.
Have you got any figures on money that we've spent in the last fiscal year or year to date as a result of not having this nurse?
Well, I don't have that. That's a good question. No, I don't. I haven't put dollar amounts to that, no.
Would have been a good thing to have.
It would have been a good thing to have, you're right.
Any more questions?
So Madam Chair, if I could also say, what we will hope to look at, again,
very much like the health clinic, this will be a trial period. Okay. This will be a one-year contract, and we would come back to the board very similar to what we did tonight and kind of give you an update on cost savings that we could project if we did have that occupational health nurse on board, and look at hopefully potential savings within our workers' comp fund as well. So it is a little bit of leap of faith on this, and we would appreciate your consideration on this. But we do see the benefits as being a long-term cost savings for us as we move forward.
I can see that communication between the doctor and this nurse going better than a patient and a doctor. I know I've dealt with my mother in that situation, and it's been sometimes difficult, but when the occupational people get involved, mm-hmm. you see a lot more progress because they understand what the doctor's saying they can and can't do, whereas an individual doesn't. And I think in the long run, you're going to get people back to work quicker because working in-house, you will know or he will mm-hmm. know what's available.
That's so, what we hope.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to accept the Occupational Health Services Agreement.
I'll do it.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Okay. The ayes have it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next is to set a public hearing for subdivision ordinance waiver request. Mr. Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, in your package you should have a memorandum from me regarding a subdivision waiver request. Specifically, the applicant is requesting a waiver from Section 34.11 of the Alamance County Subdivision Ordinance, and that is the section of the subdivision ordinance that deals with planned unit developments. The applicant is proposing the development of 29 residential condominiums and 10 commercial units off of Saxbahall Bethlehem Church Road, and this is, for lack of better terms, the River Mill there at Saxbahall, for their, where they've already had the apartments, but they're adding in condominiums and shops there now. The planning board has heard this case and has made a recommendation to the board. Staff recommends setting a public hearing date of September 7th at 7 p.m. Okay. And with that, I'd be glad to take any questions you all have.
Do we have a name of this individual? Or
it's Jordan.
Yeah, it's Jordan Mac Jordan.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice looking project, too. I mean, they brought a layout of this.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
We need a motion.
Yes, we do.
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed? All right. Thank you. Okay. Next thing is the county manager reports, Chamber of Commerce Economic Development contract.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As the board is aware, we do not have a formal contract with the Chamber to provide for economic development services. The only thing that we can formally find with respect to any type of agreement that was approved by this board was in a set of minutes that was approved back in 1986. And those minutes kind of set a parameter of the relationship between the chamber and the county. However, it's never been formalized. And part of the parameters were setting a formal contract. We've talked with a prior county attorney. They said an agreement was done at one time, but we still can't find it. So that's why we're here tonight, to ask you to formally recognize our relationship with the chamber. What you see in the agreement is basically what we are doing now. Not many changes or many different things that we're not currently doing without the agreement. We had some minor changes from the chamber. You do have a copy of that draft in front of you. A little bit different from what was in your agenda packet. The chamber made some just clarifications, and in looking at it, it really doesn't change anything substantially as far as the agreement. So we will present that for your consideration. Also, Mac Williams and Derek Steed with the chamber are here if you do have any questions.
Anybody got any questions for Mac or Derek?
Can you give us just 1 minute? Because I know I've read the contract before, but this came on the desk when we came in. So sure. Just give us a second.
Sure.
How open-ended is this?
There's a 90-day out, and again, it would go through the budget process in April, but there's a 90-day out. 10 days for calls. Or excuse me, I'm sorry, we did change that. It changed to 180, excuse me. So there's 180. That was one of the changes we originally made from 90 to 180.
I'm not going to support that 90 to 180. I think 90 is sufficient.
Yeah.
As long as they produce, I'm happy with what you're doing. I just hope you keep doing what you're doing. I think you're doing a good job.
I'm not sure that I can let you. I don't understand why you're up again.
I'd like to talk about this item that's on the agenda. I have questions about the item.
Well, the comment period's over.
It's not a comment, it's a question. Madam Chairman, in two respects, how is the contract different from that was put out in the packet, which is what we have had opportunity to review?
We can give you a copy of that. I got one in my hand. I'll give you this one.
Maybe we need to hold on.
Madam Chairman, I would like to make a comment with respect to this whole proposed agreement, in that it is a contradiction of what we were told at the May 17th commissioner meeting. That was the reason Mr. Williams, as president of the chamber, was allowed to enter a closed meeting with the commissioners. We were told that there was a contract existing, and in fact, it turns out apparently now that there was no contract.
Well, we thought it was. Evidently, I didn't see it either. So, anyway, this is something we need to discuss at another time. And if you want to put this on the agenda for us next time.
No, ma'am, I think this is related to this contract. The issue is several-fold. With respect to Durham County.
Point of order, this is not a public hearing.
No. Is there going to be a public hearing on this contract?
It depends upon what the board would like to do or not like to do. It's not required.
Okay, Eddie,
I'm thinking, with the little change that we got tonight, I'd like to look at it a little closer since you just handed us this.
And we will put this off.
And we can do that.
How is that? We'll postpone this to the next meeting.
That'll be fine.
I don't see us doing business.
We will postpone this till the next meeting.
Will there be an opportunity, Madam Chairman, to speak on the matter at that meeting?
You can sign up for public comment.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Madam Chairman, I think it might be useful in the interest of time. I'll at least pass out a letter that outlines our concerns about the chronology of this whole episode. Additionally,
I need a motion to make this change.
I'll make a motion that we table this.
Okay, have a motion and a second.
Okay,
on the favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we will table this until the next meeting.
Next on the agenda, we do have a request from Orange County on a joint meeting for the county line discussion. With respect to our local bill, we need to hold a joint meeting with Orange County so both boards can make their final determinations on landowner appeals as it relates to the Orange-Alamance line, and we must meet the December 15th deadline. and they have suggested two meeting dates, either Monday, November 29th, or Tuesday, November 30th at 7 p.m. in Hillsboro. And wanted to see if either of those work for you, or do we want to suggest different times or dates?
You say Monday the 29th and the 30th?
Yes, sir.
What time?
7 p.m.
7 p.m.
Either or. And they have suggested Hillsboro.
I don't have a problem. I don't think I can't look at my schedule.
What's wrong with Alamance County?
Meeting Mebane. That's kind of happening.
Yeah, Mebane. That's halfway.
Well, this board can't take any official action outside of Alamance County.
Right.
So if you meet in Hillsboro, you need to consider that. You have to have another meeting in this county.
Yeah, Mebane is divided.
But you could have a joint meeting in Hillsboro.
We can have a joint meeting, but we can't take any action.
No official action unless you're sitting in this county.
Okay. Well, we can come back and take official action.
Yeah.
Unless you can talk to them and see if they'll meet us in Alamance County. But they probably can't take any if they're in Alamance County.
That's true.
You meet Mebane, then go across the line.
We can drive them. We can drive them.
You play jump rope.
We can meet Eddie's house.
Can we meet
Eddie? Would that be okay?
Okay.
What was that? Monday?
It's okay to schedule that.
29th to 30th?
It's okay to schedule that.
The 29th.
The 29th or 30th, either one.
Yeah, 29th is a Monday, the 30th is a Tuesday.
Probably. Normally I don't have meetings at the end of that way.
I don't either Mondays. Especially Monday's
fine.
If the board is agreeable, we'll set it for the 29th, and I'll see if I can do a better location.
Okay.
How's that?
Okay.
There you go. They can meet one side, and we can meet the other.
Or Huey's.
It was an outlet.
Huey's. Okay, next is our consent agenda. Does anyone have anything they want to pull from the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion that we approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Have a motion. I need a second, please.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That is same. Okay, now we go to commissioners' comments.
I've got some.
Do we have any commissioners' comments? Ms. Vaughn has a commissioner's comment.
Touching out.
Ms. Vaughn, I will recognize you now.
Tim wanted to go first.
As long as you're not going to make a motion, okay. The commissioner's comments.
Okay. This is on the table. My understanding that the county attorney represents the county. Is that correct?
The board. The board. And the sheriff and the registered deeds.
Did you have a directive from the county or the county board to involve yourself in this investigation?
I was contacted by the Department of Justice, and that's how I got involved. They announced that they were going to begin an inquiry.
Okay. I went through everything that came out that you sent us, and Clyde, I'm sorry, I was real perturbed by what you had in there. You had your correspondence to the DOJ, but was that correspondence from the DOJ back to us or back to you?
I've got the first letter that Ms. Preston sent me and emails that I've been going back and forth. If you'd like to see those, I can.
Yeah, can you share those with the board? What I saw in this that you were writing to the DOJ was everything had to go through you and or the sheriff. I saw that as intimidation. That was my interpretation, that who's going to speak if, because this is just an investigation. It's not a trial in a courtroom. And I'm majorly concerned. I see it as delaying everything. I would rather see it be very open and be able to move on. That the DOJ come in here, do what they have to do. Only thing is that they're making, they're only to be making suggestions if there's anything wrong, or no suggestions if everything's just donkey-dory. That's, the community out there feels that, and I couldn't even step out my door and getting stopped by neighbors. what's going on? What are they hiding? And that's in the interpretation from what was in the paper and so forth. And I can't answer it. I don't know. I don't know that they're hiding anything. My attorney's been an attorney.
11,000 pages of documents have been sitting on the conference room table in the sheriff's office for 60 days. The Department of Justice has spent less than 2 hours looking at those documents. Any attorney that represents anyone will tell you that once you are represented, you don't talk to the other party or the other party's witnesses unless that attorney is there. They have not told us what we've done wrong. Not the first thing. They haven't told us. And they haven't looked at the 11,000 pages of documents, which I asked them to look at. They have been here, and as I say, they are still there, available for them to look through, if they so desire. That's just the ethical rules of this state, Rule 4.2, the ethical rules of the Department of Justice, that they are governed by, require attorneys to talk to attorneys when someone's being accused of something. We don't know if it's a criminal accusation. We don't know if it's a civil accusation. They won't tell us.
I don't know why we don't open it up and let them come in and do the investigation and go from there, because it's only an investigation. I'm afraid that we have unintended consequences on this. From phone calls I've received, from everywhere I turn, I'm ashamed or embarrassed. I'm not sure. I'm frustrated with the whole thing. Because I don't know. I think we're opening Pandora's box is what we're doing. I can't go along with delaying an investigation. I think it's illegal to do that. I'm sorry, I can't do that.
Let me say something. I think she's speaking for herself and not this board.
Let her get through.
Well, that's fine, Bill. If we all do that.
If you want to represent those radicals that's down here to harass them citizens of Alamance County, you at the right place.
Bill, I'm not representing anybody.
You're representing those radicals that don't care about the good things that goes on in this county. There's a lot of good things. And they're trying to put down the United States because they got radicals and they want to overthrow our government. Now, you can say what you want to say. That's a fact. I know you guys. I've studied you for years.
I said we're going to open a Pandora's box.
I'll tell you what my experience has been in investigations. If you have OSHA coming and say you know, if you have OSHA or labor or employment, equal employment opportunity to come to you and tell you you've done something wrong, they tell you what you've done wrong, they tell you who the person complained, they allow you to gather facts and take a look and see if you've done something wrong. And if you have, then you take steps to correct it. That's not happening here. We, in essence, have been told that every law enforcement officer in this county is being looked at for profiling, a pattern and practice of profile. Now, I've simply asked them where, when. Give me a name, give me a place, give me a time. Here are 11,000 records. Look at them. They can come, they can go through the records, they can tell us what we're doing wrong, and we can correct it. But they haven't done that. They have not done that.
You three?
Can I ask Miss Albright?
No, sir. You can outdoors when we get through. That's it. This is commissioner comments only. Have you got anything?
Yeah, are you through?
I don't know. I may come back after you.
I'd like to ask you a question.
Okay.
Have you talked to personally yourself or either in person or over the phone or email to a Justice Department investigator on this issue?
Absolutely not.
Okay. I don't know who you run around with as far as people that are telling you that they're ashamed or because everybody I see out in the community says keep doing what you're doing. So it's obvious there's a difference of constituency here.
We're dividing the community.
That's right. You made a motion. You tried to make a motion. And the reason I ask you the question about had you been in touch yourself with anybody with the Justice Department, I know they haven't called me and they haven't tried to contact me, so I just wondered if you'd made any inquiries. But you did try to make a motion that was ruled out of order to have a Justice Department inquiry start. And then you did have a formal motion that died for a lack of a second. And this board voted 4-1 to support Sheriff Johnson with full implementation of 287G as it was allowed by law. And, you know, it's kind of obvious here where we stand on this issue. I don't have a problem at all with my county attorney, our county attorney, representing us with counterbalances and counter checks. That's what checks and balances government is all about. I respect the Justice Department, but I definitely don't respect their being able to have a unchallenged approach to us. We have a right to say, if you want this, we want it done. We think we have a right to ask you to do it this way. Now, that's where our attorney has to come in and answer. But I certainly am not embarrassed with what we're doing here. And I hope we keep it up. And the people I see out on the street tell me to keep it up. And I don't think I run in circles that are disgraceful as far as who I think they are, as far as reputable citizens of the county. So I don't know who you talk to, but I know how they're approaching me. But I'm not embarrassed at all.
Well, Tim, it's not who I run with. Cause,
well, I didn't.
You know
what I meant.
I walk out the door and there's neighbors on the attack. I mean, you know, I go to the store and it's the same thing. And it's really people I see once every so often or happen to run to in the grocery store. It's just one of those things. I see it as, are we trying to keep adeptees quiet? And that's what I was interpreting from that they have to talk right in front of you or Sheriff Johnson. Are we trying to keep the public quiet? No, and I have not contacted them, or have they contacted me? I don't intend to contact them. I don't know what their intentions are. That's the answer to those questions. I just don't know. But I see it as a delay tactic, and that's what bothers me. After reading what you put out, can we attach this to the minutes that we have?
All of that's public record.
Yeah, what you send us, if we can attach that to the minutes, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, Mr. Boswell.
I don't have any.
Mr. Lashley.
Let me say what I was thinking. The safety of Alamance County citizens is more important than somebody being here illegal, and you guys are trying to protect them. They should come under the same laws and rules that we have to live by. If I get caught for driving with drunk, they're going to put me in jail. And they don't care if I'm an American or whatever, but they're going to put me in jail. And they should do the same thing to everybody else. If they're here illegal or if they're here on a visit, they should be treated the same. And that's all I ask.
I do have a comment since I'm last. I'm ready for them. I am like Mr. Sutton. The people that have talked to me are for the sheriff's side. They're on the sheriff's side. And I will tell you that I sat in with Ms. Parker, and I know people have heard this before. Mr. Ansbacher reminded me that I've told this before, and I'm going to tell it again. I was there. The Eddie was there the same day when Ms. Parker finished her critique of the sheriff's department, and I heard her tell him, and Eddie heard her tell Sheriff Johnson, this is what she said, quote from her mouth, Sheriff Johnson, I can see that you are not the one that is arresting the most of the Hispanics, it's the highway patrol. And I said, Ms. Parker, will you put that in the paper? And she said, yes, I will. Have you seen it in the paper? No. And if I ever see her again, I'm going to call her a liar to her face, because she did not put it in the paper, and I heard her say it from her own mouth. So that's why I have a problem with, I had a call that asked me, did Mr. Albright ask permission to do what he's doing? Mr. Albright is our attorney. But also, Fairness Alamance didn't ask me permission either to do what they're doing. So I just want that known. I have a problem with that because the sheriff's already been through it. They've already said, hey, they're not the ones that's doing it. Now they're back again. So that's my comment, and I'm done. Any announcements?
Vote Republican.
Now, wait a minute.
Strike that off.
Strike it.
It's like politics.
It's on, but right now I'm fixing to adjourn. Okay?
When you adjourn, when you lay the mic on.
It's on. This announcement is from us. Okay. Yeah, it's still on. All right. At this time, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.